On a pensé, c'est pas absolument sûr. On a pensé de commencer le show un peu plus sombre, parce que leur tenir, c'est tout comme ça, c'est un peu comme un feu d'artifice au commencement. C'est très, la lumière blanc, fort comme ça. Alors, on a pensé de commencer un peu plus sombre, un peu plus bizarre, un peu plus mystérieux. Et pour deux chansons, et le troisième de mener un peu plus léger. Alors, on discute.
Vous avez moins de 30 ans, bravo! Vous avez toujours vécu dans un monde où il y avait les Rolling Stones. Quel que soit votre âge, et juste avant les images de la tournée Voodoo Lounge et les interviews exclusives de Mickey, Ronnie et Charlie, voici un petit résumé de la situation. Dans les années 60, les Rolling Stones, c'était ça. Pareille folie méritait salaire, les Stones devinrent milliardaires. Après un premier et guignolesque passage à vide au milieu des années 70, ils reviendront, stigmatisés et littéralement sauvés par le punk rock. Au revoir, Negrita. En 1978, les Rolling Stones sont à nouveau respectables. Les années 80, rien ne va plus entre Mick et Keith. Les deux hommes songent même à dissoudre les Rolling Stones. Mais après l'échec de divers efforts solo, la machine va se remettre en marche pour une méga tournée mondiale. Steel Wheels, Urban Jungle. Les Stones n'avaient pas tourné ensemble depuis 10 ans. Ils vont pulvériser tous les records. En 1994, devine qui vient donner une conférence de presse dans le port de New York. Mais oui, mon boulou, ce sont les fabuleux Rolling Stones. Ouais, sauf que là, regarde bien. Regarde, ils ne sont plus que quatre. Problème, le cher vieux Bill Wyman, le bassiste historique, eh bien, il a quitté le groupe. Ses anciens partenaires peuvent-ils encore prétendre séduire la planète rock? Ah, that is the question.
Jagger, Keith Richards, Ronnie Wood, and Charles Watts, the Rolling Stones, here they are.
I'm going to say, we're here to announce the Rolling Stones World Tour of 1994-1995.
Criticisms by some of the media that you're just doing this for the money, right over here.
What about all the beer you can drink and all the girls down the front?
That's other things for money.
Yes, Charlie, he wants to know if this change in personnel is affected by its sound, I suspect.
No.
Do they support the legalization of marijuana?
Well, the drugs thing in this country is going every which way, so who knows? Radical solutions could be applied.
Yeah. The head office.
Woodstock 94.
We've only invited the first one, and we're not going to the second.
Rolling Stones. There they are.
Bill Wyman's a bass player for the Rolling Stones. He seemed like a friendly chap, so I asked him a couple of questions.
Have you ever thought of a height? What are you doing in 50 or 60? I had Lennon.
I've got no idea what I'm doing next year. I don't know, about 50. Yeah. I don't know. Retired.
You really have to want to do this 100%, if not more, you know, and I think Bill probably... he wasn't sure, and you can't have that in this band, you know. And so, although at first I was going to kill him quite on the El Muerto, you know.
I actually felt very sad, really, because I miss him, you know. But, I mean, I miss him not on stage so much as socially, because I like Bill, I always have done. And we've always got on, you know. And, but this is a different time. I could see why he wanted to leave. He'd had enough, and this is a different time.
I thought it would be a really big problem. As it turned out, Daryl's just came in. It's funny with the Stones, you know, like when Brian left, Mick Taylor just suddenly is there, and also into Ronnie. People just sort of turn up at the right time, you know.
Me, I'm not the new Stone anymore. No, now I have Daryl Jones, the new boy. I've done my 20 years.
How do you become the Stones bass player? Certainly you must have tried a lot of people.
Sure, I did. Last year I played with 20 bass players in 5 days. And I'd never done that before, you know. And it was very confusing. They're all great players, you know.
So what did you play?
We played an hour with each one. Five songs were the same, old Stone songs, and the rest were just things we were just playing.
I offered to have double neck, you know, play guitar.
But, Double pet too.
Obviously, that idea didn't go down very well.
So eventually what I did, I said, Charlie, you will decide.
Charlie has to feel really comfortable with a bass player.
He cursed me and said, you're going to put me in the hot seat. And I said, yeah, you know, one time in 30 years, you know.
It was either Daryl or a guy called Dougie Wimbish. And Dougie was working, so Daryl... And Daryl was much more of a rhythm section player as opposed to an on-top player, I call them. they're both as wonderful. They're both very nice people. They're both extremely good bass players. But I think Daryl's more of a rhythm section player. I think, I don't know.
He seems to fit in well, and we'll see on the stage.
You mean maybe he's not going to finish?
Maybe he's useless. No, I'm sure he'd be good. He sounds good in rehearsal.
Have Rolling Stones records in your collection?
Actually, not many. There were, you know, one or two, and actually at the time that that I bought Stones records, when I was a kid anyway, it was, you know, Angie and, you know, and those tunes, the tunes that, you know, really, you know, some of the big hits. The most recent things, you know, that I bought would have been the last, you know, few records, Steel Wheels, I bought when that came out. But I am not, I have not been a huge Rolling Stone fan. I am not a Rolling Stones aficionado by any stretch of the imagination. I like good music, you know, and I think this is a lesson that I got from Miles, is that it really doesn't matter. Everyone, you know, record people have to have names for different kinds of music, but for me, really, there are only two kinds: there's good music and bad music. And I'm, you know, just as excited to be playing with these guys as I have with anyone else that I've played with. And it's, for me, it's equally as challenging.
Do you think you're gonna finish the tour? Do you know you're, maybe you won't or what?
No, I don't have any doubts about not finishing the tour. I'm sure that everything is gonna work out fine.
About midnight, Jones went for a swim with his Swedish girlfriend, Anna Volin, and another friend, Mr. Frank Thorogood. After a time, Mr. Thorogood and the girl went back to the house. When they returned, they saw Jones at the bottom of the pool, and they pulled him out.
There is been 6 books in England about Brian Jones murders and
I heard this the dying confession of the builder. I don't know how much to, I mean, I could see that happening. Yeah, they were just fooling around Brian with Stone, and somebody just maybe, you know, kept him in the pool. I mean, I wouldn't say that it was intentional necessarily, but I know that Brian is very, very out of it then. These guys were, they were like having a lot of fun with him, you know? And he jumped in, maybe they just sort of, ha, 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 and Brian had an asthma. It could have, you know, I don't know why a guy on his deathbed was, you know, got a sudden, but at the same time, I say I could see that scenario happening. I wouldn't say, no way, you know?
I think Brian took too many downers, drank too much, and went for a swim and died. Drowned. I don't think there's any great mystery in all that. Sad, because he was a young man.
Was an old thing to say, would you let your daughter marry a Rolling Stone? Now I feel like asking you, would you let your daughter marry a Guns N' Roses?
I don't, knowing my daughter, I don't think I'd have any say in the matter.
Where did the Stones seem to lose it in the 80s? Was it drugs, the women, the easy life, easy...
No, I don't think it was any of those things. I think it was a kind of a saturation point of knowing each other. Well, especially in Mick and Keith's case, where they knew each other from children in the sandpit to grown-ups, you know, sort of how many more changes could they go through and survive, you know? It got to a dodgy, very dodgy point. But they had the strength to survive that. Yeah, luckily, which many people don't.
Yeah.
And I know what you mean with the women like Yoko and Linda, you know, sort of at loggerheads. I've been through situations like that when I was with the Faces and Rod Stewart and stuff, and it can crack into a band and eventually break them up, like a cancer that keeps tearing at the personalities, you know. And how much more can they take? But with this band, we don't have that kind of Spinal Tap thing that with the destruction. We have the Spinal Tap humor thing still going, you know. We always lose our way to the stage, you know, rock and roll. We're going the wrong way.
Hello, Cleveland.
Make me hard, you make me always said the press needs a story.
Ah.
What is the story this time?
Well,
the story.
I don't really know the story this time. The story last time was more, we hadn't been on the road for so long. The story this time is that it's another tour and here we are. And it's always the thing it put on you is, you know, is it going to be different from last time? How's it going to look? How is it going to sound? Is it going to be the same? Is it going to be new? Is it going to be old? The presentation of it is very modern this time. Whereas before, where on the stage was a kind of old technology, just all in decline. And Steel World stage was very like that. Urban Jungle too. This is much more of a cleaner look for the stage. And on top of this is this Voodoo Lounge thing, which is like the personalizing of this rather antiseptic technology. Because the stage is inspired by kind of more modern technology, which you can't really see. So on, it's the reason you put fluffy dice in your car. Oh. To personalize this object. So this is how we personalize the stage by putting the Voodoo Lounge. And the record is much more direct than maybe the last record. It's more simple in some ways, the sound. And it's got more little funny things at the edges than the last one had.
Was it an easy record to do Voodoo Lounge?
No. It wasn't easy. They're never very easy. No, there was a lot of work, actually. And there was a lot of work went into the writing. And the recording was relatively easy. But there was a lot of work in the writing, working up the songs until we got really good songs. So we spent quite a lot of time. We went in Barbados, two sessions of work there with just Keith and myself, and then we had Charlie, and then we went to Ireland, we worked with Ronnie, and went into rehearsal, and then we went to the studio. So the studio was quite short. It was like 5 weeks. It was pretty short. But it wasn't easy. But it's never really easy.
You said that for Dirty Works too.
That was terrible, no. And not such a great result. I think this is a better result, you know. So it's what makes the hard work worthwhile, and the thing you get at the end is good.
What we heard through the grapevine is that there is already enough material in the cans for another studio record. Is it true?
No. Il y a beaucoup de chansons, mais les chansons sont pas finies. Alors, j'ai fini simplement 18 chansons. Il y a beaucoup, beaucoup de morceaux qui n'ont pas fini. Alors il faut travailler sur ces morceaux, finir toutes les paroles et tout ça. Mais non, ils n'ont pas un autre disque tu prêtes, malheureusement.
So Don Was is a new Stones producer. What kind of job is it to produce the Stones?
C'est un travail très dur. C'est difficile parce que il faut être diplomate, exigeant, pas trop exigeant. Il travaille beaucoup les heures, plus même que le groupe, tout ça. C'est très difficile pour le problème. Moi, je ne peux pas être cette personne. Mais Don, il est très cool. Et parce que Don, il est musicien. Alors, la plupart des producteurs, les moitiés sont les ingénieurs du son avant. Et le deuxième, c'est les producteurs. Ce sont les musiciens. Don, il joue le basse. Il était dans un groupe. La groupe ont eu beaucoup de problèmes. il comprend tous les problèmes du groupe. Mais il est très patient. Aussi, il est très bon pour choisir les chansons. Comme vous avez dit avant que nous avons plein de chansons, il faut avec quelqu'un qui dit oui, c'est ça qui est bon, ça, mais ça c'est pas. Je dis. ils sont tous bons, ils sont tous fantastiques. Mais dans moi j'ai eu plein de bagarres sur cette question des chansons avec lui, mais il est très poli. Et il est très gentleman, il n'est pas difficile. J'aime bien.
This is your first official record without Bill Wyman. Did it change anything?
Well, he wasn't there. C'est pas un grand change pour moi, vraiment. Parce que le bass, c'est pas un instrument qui est tout à fait là. C'est pas là, c'est toujours un peu derrière. Alors, c'est pas une grande chose. Mais d'avoir, c'est bon d'avoir quelqu'un de nouveau, et c'est donc un peu un cul de pied. C'est bon. J'aime bien. Mais Bill, il veut pas continuer. On peut pas forcer les gens qui ne peuvent pas.
So, let's talk about the cover of Voodoo Lounge. Who is this character, which some people at Virgin call the Banana Man?
He's a zombie. He's a zombie in Haitian voodoo. He's the one that does the work while everyone sleeps. He comes back. He's the undead person.
And so, in the inside cover, there's this double skeleton page. It's frightening stuff, no?
That's the dinner of the dead.
Did you put
sort of
that
dead beggar's banquet?
Yeah. Is it on purpose to get people talking, or do you really?
Oh, I thought it was a really interesting photograph. It's an old photograph. It's not new. Found in a French book, actually. And I think it's a good picture. It seemed to fit in well with the theme.
The Stones logo, the famous tongue, has changed too. Now, could you explain what it means?
Well, we changed it last time, and it's nice to make a few variants. So this looks spiky. Looks like kind of a tongue of a spiky sex toy, really.
Look, what kind of advice would you give to a group of kids who is rehearsing in a garage and dream of being the Rolling Stones, or
be something different? Get a good song, I don't know. I think the songs are the keys to all these things, really. I mean, obviously you have to play them with enthusiasm. You know, the songs is the key.
Are you tempted to produce another young band like when you did Living Colour a few years ago?
It's good fun doing that. And when this is finished, maybe I'll do that with a band. It's good fun.
Do you still have a house in France?
Yes.
So you've been living in France off and on for years. What is it?
I have a holiday place.
What is it that you like about French people?
I have a house in France. I didn't speak about French people. No, I mean, it's beautiful there, and you know, it's very relaxing, and I enjoy the people around me. It's nice. And I used to go there as a child, so it's, you know, it's a long time I've been going there.
And what is it you dislike about French people?
Dislike? What is there to dislike? I mean, they're always polite and nice and kind and hospitable and warm, just like the English. And they always wash, like the English do.
Okay, what is it, what do you like and dislike about you?
Ça, c'est très difficile, moi, je peux pas. Vous avez cette show en France, dans le pauvre type sur le psychiatre, sur la télé. C'est horrible, ça, non? C'est une blague. Je ne peux pas faire la même chose sur moi. Merci.
Bit of reality. Okay, since we last met, England is no longer an island. Will it make a difference for you?
On va essayer, non? On va essayer le train souterrain. Encore les minutes, c'est pas. Peut-être c'est bon, peut-être pas. Non? C'est pas. On va essayer.
If the Beatles reform, will you go to the concert?
No, je n'aime pas au début. Maintenant, c'est peut-être pire, non?
I catch you right before the end of the World Cup. So what are your predictions on the winner?
This is going to come out before the World Cup?
No, after.
What a cheat! Well, maintenant, on ne sait pas même les équipes du final. If Italy lose, it's like the 3 months in Italy, you can't go there, you know, it's dead. Nobody goes out.
Do you sing for yourself, and when was the last time you sang all alone?
Oh, all the time. In the bath, everyone does it. Dans la douche, là, le matin.
What do you sing then?
Dans le bain? La chanson populaire du moment. Like, he says your boyfriend, he says your boyfriend, he says your boyfriend, but it wasn't last night.
Do you do your own choreography for the stage?
Yeah, I have a guy that helps me too. And we discuss, and he says, that was good, that was... You look terrible doing that, you look like a monkey. And so it's good to have someone look at you, because, you know, so they look at you. So it's, you know, it's good to have someone to help. But he doesn't actually tell me exactly what to do. It's impossible for me.
Quand est-ce qu'on vous voit en France?
Quand je fais visite. Non, pour les shows, je ne sais pas, parce qu'on n'a pas fait le booking pour les shows, mais j'espère dans l'année prochaine. L'année prochaine, dans le mois juin, juillet, comme ça. Avant les vacances. Bon, merci.
Merci beaucoup.
Merci
beaucoup, monsieur Tiber. speaking of the Stones, are you proud of what you've achieved with them?
Yeah, sure. Overall, yeah. And especially right now, they've really sort of found their stride again, you know? Because it was the whole of the 80s, that was kind of hard for us, and a band either breaks up or it doesn't. And that would be kind of a boring way to go, you know, and they just sort of falling apart.
All these years with the Stones, and you never did a drum solo. Do you miss it?
Thank God for that. No, I don't. I don't like drum solos.
But there is a lot of bands, new bands coming out these days, garage bands, and they all seem to have a Ronnie Wood look-alike in the band. Does it bother you? Do you think it's an homage? Or?
Well, what they try to do is they try to look like Keith, but they end up looking like me. So it's partly their mistake.
Rolling Stone. There they are.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much for coming. We are very, very happy. What a wonderful bunch of guys.